welcome to weekdaychurch.com. I hope you're having a wonderful day as the weekend is approaching, and that's always an exciting, thank God it's Friday kind of moment for you and everything. Today, what we're looking at is one of the things I remember I said some as a kid, and I remember other kids said to me sometimes when you'd get in the middle of a scrap, you may start it, but I'll finish it. And I think sometimes it's that kind of an idea that we need to see a little more in life is, you know, I don't really want to start a fight, but I'm not going to have any problem finishing it. As we look at our scripture today in Esther, we're going to see that's exactly where Mordecai and the rest of the Jews stand on this. They didn't start this fight. They didn't want this fight. But once somebody else did start this fight, they didn't have any problem getting in the mix of it and finishing that fight. So often as Christians, even as church leaders, we know that there are troublers in the church. Sometimes the wolves jump right out and they show themselves to be what they are. And instead of just finishing it and being done with it, we pussyfoot around and get all sissy about it, and we let them tear up all kinds of people before we act and react, if we ever do. But you know, at times the best thing to do is once somebody starts that fight, to just finish it. If it's a good person who's made a mistake and gotten something, and all you had to do is fat their lip and black their eye, you know what? They'll apologize and say they're sorry and say, man, I should have never done that. I have been on both sides of that before. I've won and lost fights that I, you know, should have never been in the midst of, or the other person should have never started. I have got beat down before and had to look at the guy after he beat me up and say, you know, I should have never thrown that first punch. I'm sorry, man. It was my fault while I'm sitting there bleeding all over the place. You know, that's what happens sometimes. If it's a good person, they'll get that. They'll understand that. But if you're talking a true wolf, you know, a wolf will bite its own leg off. You know, it will not stop, and it will come after you, and it will kill you. Your job is, again, as we said before, you have every right to protect yourself and those you love. But don't do it half-hearted. You finish it. Be done with it. And make sure that your enemy cannot come back to do this again to hurt you or other people. Heavenly Father, we've seen what you're going to do. You said that you did not create hell for us, but you created hell for the devil and his angels. For those angels who rebelled against you and fell, you created a place of eternal torment. You're not messing around with them. It will all be done one day. And even those who are here, even though it wasn't created for us, that do not accept your love and kindness, your mercy and grace through the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, who they killed, Heavenly Father, they will too join them there. Not for temporary suffering, not for a, hey, I hope they learn something and I'll get them out. But God, it says, where the worm dieth not, where it's an everlasting fire, where they will stay forever. God, may we stop messing around with the enemies of God. May we give them every chance to repent. But God, let us not look at the wolves in sheep's clothing who are here to kill and destroy your church and your people and play with them. God, may we be bold and brave. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our opening song today is We Believe. It's by the Newsboys. I picked this song because it is a bold song. It is a statement saying this is who we are and where we stand. I'll see you right after the song.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than ever.
Scripture passage today is a little long. It's Esther chapter 9, verses 5 through 17. The Jews struck all their enemies with the sword, killing and destroying them, and did as they pleased to those who hated them. In Susa, the citadel itself, the Jews killed and destroyed 500 men, and also killed Parshandatha, and Dalphon, and Aspatha, and Paratha, and Adalia, and Aradatha, and Parmashtha, and Arasai, and Aradai, and Vizatha, the 10 sons of Haman, the son of Hamadatha, the enemy of the Jews. But they laid no hand on the plunder. That very day, the number of those killed in Susa, the citadel, was reported to the king. And the king said to Queen Esther, "In Susa, the citadel, the Jews have killed and destroyed 500 men, and also the 10 sons of Haman. What then have they done in the rest of the king's provinces? What is your wish? It shall be granted to you. And what further is your request? It shall be fulfilled." And Esther said, "If it please the king, let the Jews who are in Susa be allowed tomorrow also to do according to this day's edict, and let the 10 sons of Haman be hanged on the gallows." So the king commanded this to be done. A decree was issued in Susa, and the 10 sons of Haman were hanged. The Jews who were in Susa gathered also on the 14th day of the month of Adar, and they killed 300 men in Susa, but they laid no hands on the plunder. Now the rest of the Jews who were in the king's provinces also gathered to defend their lives, and they got relief from their enemies and killed 75,000 of those who hated them, but they laid no hands on the plunder. This was the 13th day of the month of Adar, and on the 14th day, they rested and made that day a day of feasting and gladness. They demolished them. I mean, in just the capital, they killed 500 people and Haman's 10 sons so that there would be no chance for vengeance from the wicked sons of Haman to carry on his evil deeds or to seek revenge. They killed 510 people, and when the king says, "Are you happy? Is it all done?" the queen looks at him in boldness and says, "No, we need one more day to finish mopping up." And they kill another 300 enemies of the Jews. 810 people in the capital, right in front of the king's face, and he's willing to let it happen so that there can be an end to the evil. He hated it. He wasn't happy. He goes, "You already killed 500 people." But he knew, you may as well finish what you started. 75,000 people throughout the rest of his provinces. It's a lot of people that had to die. A lot of wicked people out there. We so often believe in our naivety. We both so often want to hope because we don't want to have to deal with it. That once we've done one little thing, we've purged all the wickedness. But God's people have always had enemies. Not only the Jews, but also the Christians. They have had those who've come against them. Paul says, "I have been beaten and whipped. I have been shipwrecked. I've been stoned. I've been hurt. I've been everything you could ever imagine." And he puts it very clearly, both outside the church and inside the church. He says that there will be wolves in sheep's clothing in every church. That there will be, in other words, wicked people planted there by the devil who are only there to eat the sheep. That's it. And we are surprised when certain people in the church act wicked. You know, even the best of us can do terrible things. And then when we are confronted, and there must be confrontation, when we are confronted, you know what? Those who are right with God will humble themselves and say, "Forgive me." But those who are wicked will just make excuses or keep on fighting. Do not listen to it. Make sure they change or make sure they're done. That's it. One of my favorite books is Ender's Game. They made a movie of it recently. The movie wasn't nearly as good as the books. If you haven't read the books, I do recommend them. There's an entire series of those books, and they're fantastic. But none of them quite come up to the level of the very first one, Ender's Game. It's about this little kid who's going to save the world. I don't want to take too much away from it. But he will do what he has to do to protect himself and those that he cares about. But he doesn't get in a fight at half measures. If he does something, he finishes it. And one of the quotes from the book says this: "Ender Wiggin isn't a killer. He just wins thoroughly. His goal is never to hurt anybody past the point he has to. But he's going to finish it so that whoever is bad enough to come up against him or the people he loves once does not have the opportunity to do it a second time." Once evil has reared its head in your life, whether it just be a demon, whether it just be your own passions, or whether it be a true enemy person out there, do not let it happen to you a second time. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the wiles of the devil and fight against it with everything that you have in you. Do not let it come back to you a second time to strike you again and to deliver the mortal blow that you failed to give yourself. Come against it with all that you have and all the power that God puts in your life and finish it and move on. Heavenly Father, let us learn from Mordecai and from Esther. They are brave. They're courageous. They have great wisdom. And it's not that they are unkind. But God, they lived in a hard time. And to protect their people, they were willing to do whatever was necessary. God, may any of us that may be in church leadership or family leadership do whatever it takes to not only protect ourselves, but moreover to protect those whom you've given us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.